Yeah, I love the bass. I love the kick drum. And I love the hi-hats, actually. It's a really interesting sound.
Yeah.
And what's the reverb at the beginning? It's so spacey.
It's actually a convolution reverb on Ableton. It's just for the Max for Live, and it's just incredible. I think it was, I think it's in like an old cathedral. I'll try and find it for you, but it just sounds so spacey and
massive.
It really does, doesn't it?
Yeah. And also I love how you do these like little sharp breaks where even like the reverb's cut out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So tell me a bit about how the track came together, because it's awesome.
So originally the kind of piano and melody that you hear in the intro was something that I was kind of playing around for my own like artist project. And yeah, it just never really got used. And like I was saying before, I just kind of lost what I was doing with my own artist project. And we were in LA and I just met Tara, which is Arcana. And yeah, we were doing a writing session and I pulled this up and thought, you know, let's see if this works. And then instantly we all just kind of clicked with it and I started writing the song, and it just came out within minutes. We had like a pretty much full song. And yeah, it was, you know, it's just a great process. What we were trying to focus on there was kind of how can we show like the vibe of the song with the production. And obviously, so it's Stockholm syndrome. So it's kind of, you know, being stuck in a situation but also at the same time enjoying it or loving it in a strange, creepy way. And so I think the piano kind of captures that. And then we wanted to take it just somewhere completely different for the chorus and just kind of, you know, how can we shock the listener? How can we kind of take it to another place that you wouldn't expect it to go, and kind of replicate Stockholm syndrome? And that's where the big trappy 808 comes in, and right. You know, it's and you have this kind of like apocalyptic guitar tones going in the background that are just like drenched in reverb, and you know, it's very much about creating the vibe and the feel of that, I think.
Nice. Well, how did you make those hi-hat sounds?
So I think that's actually tom drums that I pitched up super high and just, yeah, kind of
like toms.
Yeah. just because whatever I kind of did there, I remember spending a lot of time on those hi-hats, to be honest, because nothing I did kind of worked. It wasn't kind of gelling with the rest of the song. And I don't know, I just started playing with some toms and he kind of had this like funky rhythm. I was like, oh, this kind of works, but I don't like the tom sound. And then, yeah, it just kind of pitched them up and it worked as like a hi-hat rhythm.
That's so cool. Yeah, I mean, I find trap hi-hats like are usually a little bit too in your face for me.
Yeah.
Like maybe it's because I come more from like the rock and roll world. So like just like it's like a little too harsh and intense.
Yeah.
Like I like a little bit more of a mellow kind of hi-hat for like a trap sound, I guess.
Exactly. So, yeah,
spoke to me.
I think like we kind of wanted to get away from trap as well. I didn't want it to be
right
super trap and, you know, kind of take
right away. Still a pop song.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think, you know, definitely we wanted to avoid the trappy hats that, you know, it's not
yeah
it's not what we wanted to do with that.
Nice. What was the bass instrument?
That is Serum. So I just created like an 808 on Serum, and it's just do you use Serum?
No, I don't.
So it has like a parallel compressor on there, and it just like crushes the bass and put like some tube distortion. A super simple patch, and it just sounds great, to be honest.
Everyone talks about Serum. I've just never felt like buying it because I have so many other instruments, but obviously it's a classic. But I guess like EDM is not something that I've gone hard down that road. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I like it, but I've never gone, I guess, that hard down it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. But
maybe one day. They have the rent-to-own programs, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's worth a try.
Is that what you do?
Yeah, pretty much.
I'll consider it. Nice, man. Do you usually use Nicholas for mastering, or do you have another mastering engineer that you work with?
Yeah, like, it is Nick, like 99.9% of the time. Unless, like we were discussing before, it just like they don't have the budget for it. But like I will always use Nick because he always smashes it out of the park. I don't even consider anyone else.
Yeah, and you never master yourself, even with like the budget.
Never master. I will just kind of say it needs to be mastered. Let's try and find the budget, or let's try and find a way of getting it mastered. Just because anything that I kind of will master will just ruin the song, essentially. Like I was saying before the show, it's like a dark art, mastering. It's something that I probably should be able to do in a kind of technical sense, but I just can't do it at any kind of standard that someone like Nick can do. So, you know, why even bother?
That's amazing. Yeah, I feel like I get such a variety of answers about mastering, because like some people are like, yeah, you know, I'm going to get it close enough, or and like to people that like, I just can't even think about mastering, you know? Yeah. And I've kind of slowly moved to the camp of, I don't want to, I have no objectivity left anymore by the time I finish the mix. Like, yeah. I just, how am I supposed to do that at that point, you know?
Exactly, yeah. I feel very similar. It's, you know, by that point, I've kind of exhausted all my technical abilities. So I feel like I just need to have someone else that's going to polish it off and make it sound perfect.
Yeah, absolutely. So actually something I was thinking about, which is interesting, is you have a lot of experience with like sync licensing and like doing stuff for corporate. Like, I guess, do you have any tips for people that are interested in getting into that world, trying to get more their songs licensed and just like how to pitch it?
I mean, to be honest, it just kind of fell into my lap in a sense. A lot of it has been through network. And I mean, some of the stuff, like I've started working for Walmart recently, and I've been producing, I produced their, the track for their latest fashion campaign. And that was kind of through an artist that I work with at the minute. And they kind of passed my name on, and, you know, the publishing companies that I've worked with have, it's always been through word of mouth. Like it's been a connect through someone else. So I'll go back to my original point, whereas, you know, your network is pretty much everything you've got. Like, find the people right. that you need to speak to. And you know, it's not always just the big execs and the, you know, supervisors. It's just producers or, you know, artists. Just speak to as many people as you can. Build your network.
Yeah.
And, you know, you'll be surprised at what kind of comes out of it.
It's interesting you say that, because, like, I'm literally talking to as many music producers as I possibly can on this podcast. And I guess when I started this podcast, I guess I was looking to grow an audience and hopefully, you know, it would help my career. And but I got to say, the number one thing that came out of me doing this podcast so far is just meeting so many amazing people.
Yeah.
Just like opening the doors to like have conversations with people that are so much better than me, have so much different experience than me is just an incredible, it's been an incredible opportunity for me. So
yeah.
If you want to start a podcast, that's a good reason to do it.
Well, there you go.
But so when you were announced as a Vodafone future breaker, like did that really get the ball rolling in that sense? Or was that maybe like an afterthought?
So, I mean, at the time, like I said before, I was kind of, I used to go weeks or months where I'd kind of not do any music and, you know, feel really bad about it. And at the time I was in one of those like troughs. I was very much down about music and what I was doing. And then this kind of happened and I was just like, what, like, how did this even happen? You know, it just didn't make any sense to me that someone could, because this was kind of like the first time, like, I suppose I got noticed for what I was producing. Because the song that they picked was essentially the first time I was producing a song and thought, I'm just going to do what sounds good. Which kind of takes me back to my original point before. You know, it's beforehand I was kind of thinking, how can I create a sound like this person? Or, you know, but this was the first time I just kind of thought, I'm going to do what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it till it sounds good. And to be recognized for that was like unbelievable to me, because, oh, actually that works. Like, people like what I make and, you know, what I think sounds good. Other people agree. So I think from that point, it kind of made me realize, actually, I can do something with this. And, you know, from that kind of publicity as well, I got like interest from publishing companies and library music companies, and just started speaking to some music supervisors. And yeah, it kind of started rolling from there, really.
Wow, that's amazing. And I think that's like an amazing takeaway for the listeners, is just like kind of how we were saying at the beginning, you can only be the best you, right? You can't be the best anyone else. And
exactly.
And that just speaks loads to that, just proves the point, I guess.
Yeah, 100%.
So, yeah, thanks for sharing that, man.
No problem.
So, Chris, we've spoken about a lot of things, and I was going to ask you, what's like the one thing that you wish you had known at the beginning of your journey and you only found out later on? And clearly, I think you just answered it about, you know, finding your own voice and just and doubling down on that. So
yeah.
I'm assuming that's what you would have said.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think just trust your own kind of creativity. Find people that you can speak to, you know, find your network, your group of people that you trust, and you'll be amazed about, you know, how far you can kind of take this thing.
Amazing. How can the audience find you on the interwebs?
Yes. So I'm chris-durkin.com. That's my website. You can find all the kind of music that I'm doing on there. And on Instagram as well, I'm Chris Durkin with two N's on the end because someone stole my name. And and on Facebook is Chris Durkin DJ as well. When I used to DJ quite a lot, but not really much anymore. So yeah,
right.
You know, reach out to me. Let's have a chat.
Into the cozy studio life.
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah, it's nice and warm in here.
Nice. Yeah, I can see the sweatshirt on. Well, Chris, this has been really, really fun, and we spoke about new topics and got into it. So I'm really happy about that. So thank you for sharing your story and sharing your insights.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
It's been a pleasure meeting you.
Yeah, you too.
So, yeah.
Thank you so much.
I hope to come back to England at some point in my life.
Do it. Yeah, come to Manchester. We'll go out for some food.
It sounds great.
Awesome.
All right, man. Take care.
You too.
And stay safe. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of Secret Sonics. I hope you enjoyed my conversation with Chris as much as I did. If you enjoyed this episode or any of our other episodes, I'd super appreciate it if you would go to Apple Podcasts and leave us a rating and review. It really helps the show. And if you could share this episode or your favorite episode with a friend or two, that would also really help the show move forward. In addition to that, you can find us on social media. Just search for Secret Sonics. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. And you can email me at secretsonics@gmail.com if you have any comments, feedback, guests you might want to recommend, anything like that. So that's about it for now. Until next time, I hope you guys have a great week. Stay safe out there and dig in. Bye-bye.